squad bay doors, please, Hal.
Mr. Klaus,
you have a gift. You were meant for making toys. So I figured if you donate your old toys, I'll deliver them for free.
Tonight, I go with you.
There's no need for you to come with me, really. Tonight, then.
Our cousin told us if we write a letter to Mr. Klaus, he'll make us a toy.
Dear Mr. Klaus.
Dear Mr. Klaus.
Shall we, then?
Yep.
Mr. Klaus is the coolest.
Klaus? What about me?
Ow! What the?
Loser!
Oh, yeah? Well, if I'm a loser, then you're too far. You're gone.
Hey, what do you guys think you're doing? This is Smearensburg, the unhappiest place on Earth. And you two can't change that.
The postman and toy maker are brainwashing everyone!
We need to show people that a true selfless act always sparks another.
Hi! What's happening right now?
Oh, no.
Holy mother!
What happened?
Not a word. You just sit there. Be all magical and awesome.
Jesper, we're doing it.
Let's go!
Oh, oh, oh!
Wait. Time out. Really? That's how you laugh? Come on, we're running out of time. Those kids are counting on us.
If we don't stop them tonight, this town will never be the same.
Destroy those toys!
No! No! Ah! Ha! Eat our snow, you... They're not attached. Why aren't they attached? I thought they were attached. I would never in a million years have done what I just did if I didn't think these were attached. Always have high hopes.
The pod bay doors are open. Welcome once again. I'm your host, Jerry Dean Roberts of armchaircinema.com and overthinkingoscars.wordpress.com. Seated here with my holly jolly co-host, the critic, dare I say legend, from talkwithamy.com, the one and only Mr. Doug Heller. How the heck are you today, sir?
Jack, please. I'm only an elected official here. I can't make decisions by myself.
Welcome to our annual holiday four-pack. I do this every year. I do this to Doug every year. I pick four movies that generally I don't think would make great episodes, but I pick a theme revolving around Christmas, and we talk about all four. Last year we did horror films.
And I'll tell you what, the four you picked this year,
it's an eclectic.
Three of them are really good.
It's an eclectic group.
Three of them are perennial worthy.
Right.
One of them, I'm still not really sure why you had me watch it.
We're talking about, is it called Klaus or Claus? I think it's called Klaus.
I say Klaus.
It's from 2009. Well, they say Klaus.
Yeah.
It's from 2019. And second is Beauty and the Beast, the Enchanted Christmas, just because I gotta throw a Disney bone into the animation. Then Tokyo Godfathers. Then Nightmare Before Christmas.
Nightmare Before Christmas is a Disney movie.
It is. Well, it is now. Yeah. And then we're gonna end this with a great film, Shoshiro Oni's Tokyo Godfathers. But first, let's start with Klaus. Damn you, Klaus!
Doesn't anyone want to hear what I have to think?
This was nominated for the best animated feature in 2019.
Rightfully so.
Rightfully so. I forgot to look up the other nominees, but I know the winner was was Toy Story 4.
Mm-hmm.
That just stinks of, as much as I love Toy Story 4, that just stinks of, we took the one that was the most familiar.
Mm-hmm.
And it was, this is the first time I'd ever seen this.
Oh, I saw this back in 2019 when it came out, when it was when it was nominated for stuff, because I either the OFCS had it nominated for something for animation, mm-hmm. or it was just because it was nominated for the Oscars that that I saw it. But I really enjoyed it, and when you said you were picking it, I was excited, because I really do enjoy this one. It's a
it's one that I didn't get to. It's a Netflix production.
It is. The other ones that were nominated that year,
Toy Story 4,
Missing Link, which was a Laika stop motion,
and it's surprisingly good.
Oh, it's really good. I Lost My Body, which is stunningly weird.
I haven't seen that one.
That one's weird. And How to Train Your Dragon 3, mm-hmm. which was pretty good too. But I think out of all of those,
it stinks of late DreamWorks. You know, DreamWorks was running out of gas. But this, I think this is my favorite of those five.
Oh yeah,
because the animation is really what carries it for me. It's not 3D animation. It's 2D animation run through with computer animation.
With computer lighting.
Yeah, with computer lighting. It looks like a storybook.
It looks like 3D animation, but it is all hand-drawn 2D.
Mm-hmm.
Absolutely gorgeous to look at.
Mm-hmm.
Fluid... It's the writer director Sergio Pablos said that he wanted to animate the movie as if he felt the progression of hand drawn animation would be if the switch to digital to computer hadn't happened.
Yeah.
So he kind of tracked out kind of the one of the last like hand-drawn ones and kind of tracked out how things would have evolved, and he made Klaus incorporating 3D lighting, which just, I mean, it just makes everything look amazing.
The experiments with computer animation are an ever-evolving process.
Mm-hmm.
Because Toy Story, the original Toy Story, doesn't look like Cars.
No.
And Cars doesn't look like Inside Out. You can see, if you watch those movies in progress, you can see the animation. The only problem with Pixar is they stay in that.
Mm-hmm.
I like a variety of things, and that's what we have on this show.
Mm-hmm.
And when it's done well, you notice it. When it's not done well, you notice it.
Yeah.
There is a reason in picking four animated features for this show, I passed over Polar Express. Because Polar Express, it was a noble attempt at something that didn't work.
Oh, I hate that movie.
I know what they were trying to do.
It doesn't work.
It's a story that doesn't really work.
I don't really understand how it's become so beloved.
You know, I think it's become divided.
Yeah, I mean, I think people really at the time loved it because of the book. I think that they were familiar with the book.
And the concept.
Yeah, the movie never got me. Not even for like 5 minutes. Like, I never was in that. And I'm really glad you didn't pick that, because there's that, and there was, didn't Zemeckis do with Jim Carrey with the Christmas Carol?
Yeah, I passed over that too.
Yeah, thankful.
Here's a problem I had picking these four films is, whenever I go to find the greatest animated Christmas movies, and I specify features, I specify movies, they keep giving me 25-minute specials. They kept giving me, oh, Charlie Brown Christmas. No, that's not a movie. That's a television special.
Yeah. It's,
and, you know, Grinch Who Stole Christmas. No, the Grinch Who Stole Christmas is a television special.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, stuff like that. And I was like, okay, you're not picking features. And that just tells me there's a finite number of these things.
Well, there's a finite number of good ones.
Really good ones, yeah. The one that I discovered, and I really almost bent the rules on this one, was Mickey's Christmas Carol. Because
actually, that's not bad. I've seen that a few times.
I saw that the other night. It is really good. Unfortunately, they shove it into 25 minutes.
Yeah.
And it blows by, and it's like, okay, there's no nuance to it because it has to be that short.
Yeah, but it's Scrooge McDuck as mm-hmm. Ebenezer Scrooge.
Right.
And it really does a whole lot of good stuff.
What it does very well.
Right, right.
But it's a short. It's a television short.
Mm-hmm.
But as for Klaus, I didn't know what to expect. It's a wacky comedy.
It is.
With a lot of pathos.
Yeah.
The story is not blindingly original, but what they do with it is really effective.
The way that, yeah, the incorporating the postal workers, and
well, it's that the snob is sent to the remote village and he hates it and he's trying to get away from it, and then he finds a purpose. Mm-hmm. And I thought of Emperor's New Groove, because it's somebody taken out of their element, and he grows as a person. I think this does it a lot better than that film did.
Yeah.
Mostly because Jason Schwartzman's a better actor.
Yeah.
Was he at a military training camp?
No, he was at the post office training camp. But
was
it
he?
Was,
okay.
This is set, I want to say, some
turn of the 19th century.
Yeah. Yeah.
But based on the clothes.
Right. And Smearensburg is a fictitious town, but it's based on a real town that's up in the uppermost parts of Scandinavia, Norway, I think. Mm-hmm. And
up toward the North Pole.
Yes. Yes, it's yeah. Very, very remote.
Because for a minute, that's actually where I thought they were going to send him.
Right, right.
You know, when the father is kind of he takes that stick and he's looking up the map. He's going up the map, up, 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 up. And I thought, okay, he's going to the North Pole. No, he finds this small island right there. What is the name of it?
Smearensburg.
Smearensburg. He finds that tiny little island.
Right, and it's there's no there's no working post office there, because the inhabitants of the island for generations upon generations have been feuding against each other, so they have no need to send mail to each other.
Yeah.
And they don't interact with the mainland, so
right.
They did, there was no need for one.
Mm-hmm.
But Jason Schwartzman's character, Jesper, finds Klaus, which I don't know about you, but Santa Claus being voiced by J.K. Simmons just felt right.
It takes a while to get there.
A long time.
Because they establish that this town is essentially dead. There's no joy. You know, there's no joy in this town at all. There's no life in it. And that's to a purpose.
Yeah, the kids don't play.
No.
They don't go to school.
Mm-mm.
They're not allowed to socialize with the other.
And they for damn sure don't have Christmas.
Right. And the whole point is to foster anonymity. so that they keep these feuds going.
Right.
Nobody knows why they started.
Yeah. The one character I can't stand is when he gets to the, when he gets there, Jesper gets there, there's this one character who keeps smirking at him and making fun of him. And that character keeps doing that all through the movie. It's the character voiced by Norm Macdonald. Mm-hmm. But he keeps doing that all through the movie. And even at the end, he's still doing that. And it's just like, okay, come on. There's Jesper is, at the end of this movie, a long way from where he started.
Yeah, but I think...
And I felt like this guy was like,
his,
okay...
Mogens was his, name.
Mogens, yeah. Funny at the beginning.
At the beginning, he's doing
it's Norm Macdonald.
By the end of it, he's doing it because it's kind of... He knows that it's no longer applicable.
Yeah.
So it's just... It's kind of their... It's their inside joke because they have become... They have clearly become friends.
Yeah.
Because he's become friends with the entire town. Except
well,
Joan
he's
Cusack.
Become a hero to the town.
Except Joan Cusack.
Except Joan Cusack. And Will Sasso.
Right.
Who... This is a movie of very weird hats.
Yes. This is like watching... this is like watching like the Box Trolls or something, but animated.
Yeah. Because when they make ugly characters, they make really ugly characters. But he sees something on the map and he says, "Who lives in that woodcarver shack?" And this is 20 minutes into the movie.
Yeah.
And he goes up there and he finds this sullen, hulking man. This almost walking terror. And he's a
walking brick wall.
Yeah. Yeah. He's about the size of the Hulk.
Yeah.
He's an old woodcarver. And he's got, and you can tell it's the same old story. He's got a sour past. Mm-hmm. There's a great moment when Jesper is trying to talk to him and trying to draw some humanity. And he's making a noose. Mm-hmm. And it turns out it's for these bird feeders that he throws up into the trees. Right. I love those bird feeders. I was listening to this on my computer with my headphones on. And there are a couple of moments of quiet when you can hear those bird feeders clacking together. Mm-hmm. It's kind of a beautiful, almost musical sound. Mm-hmm. And... but he has basically given up on everything. Mm-hmm. And that's because he suffered a tragedy.
His wife couldn't bear children, and then she got sick, probably cancer, and died. Mm-hmm. And
well, this is the turn of the century. You can pretty much die of anything. You'd probably die of the common cold.
Actually, yeah, you could.
Yeah. And probably would have died in childbirth, but
many did.
What I love about this is there's this building idea, because he starts to get the mail going.
Right, because he sees that Klaus has this barn filled with wooden toys. Mm-hmm. And
well, he starts with the letters.
First thing that happens, though, like the letter, that drawing that kid made,
right,
falls out of his pocket, and he
he's
sees
trying
it,
to be a con artist,
and he sees it, and he decides to give them the kid a toy, and he's like, "Hey, do you want to do this again?" And so he starts up these letters telling these kids, you know, if you write this letter, I'll deliver it to him and he'll get you a toy. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, he made those promises before he talked to Klaus.
Right.
But Klaus agreed, and until all of the toys were gone, he kept doing that. And all the while, Jesper is getting a functional postal service there. His job was to get that done in a year and have 6,000 letters.
Yeah, that's why they sent him there.
And then he could come back and live in his father's mansion. He is a very, 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 very upper crust.
Spoiled.
Yeah.
You see him in the, he's lounged back, he's got his sunglasses on, he's sipping a drink, and he's being waited on hand and foot.
Right, he's at the
Academy. And that's why he's sent there.
Right, he's at the Academy, and he's in his own private tent while people are running drills, and he's like, I've got somebody doing that for me.
Mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. just the worst. Just, and, now, he tries to do this so that he can get out of there.
Mm-hmm.
But a result of all of this happening, he starts seeing all this goodwill that's generated, and he gets caught up in genuinely doing something good.
Mm-hmm.
That he forgot that his motives were disingenuous.
Yeah.
And by the time they were discovered, he was like, oh yeah, I did do that, didn't I?
Yeah.
Like, oops.
And it really, what they do is they end up going into business together, and they end up, the children send letters, he sends back toys, he gives out toys. Jesper's kind of a con artist, because he gets this idea that he will only send you a toy if you're good.
Right,
he's always watching.
He starts manipulating this and starts developing this theory, mythos around him, and
building him up as Santa Claus, basically.
Right, right. And he's helped along because there was a big chase, and in the sleigh lost the wheels because it was a wagon.
Mm-hmm.
The reindeer are running, they're at this top speed.
I love this.
And they run off a ramp, and they do an ET across the moon, and this little kid
across this window.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And this little kid sees them, and then they just crash out.
Yeah.
Because they weren't doing it on purpose. But he runs into the post office the next day and says, "You are not gonna believe what I saw him do." And
of course, the meanies in town don't like that.
Right, because it takes away from their hatred. And, you know, Emperor Palpatine, or Mrs. Crumb, sorry, John Cusack, she's, you know, good, your hate has made you powerful, you know, yes.
Tinting the fingers, yes. Excellent.
And they basically after this all takes off, and he meets his requirement, they write to the main office so that the father can come and say, well, okay, you did what you were supposed to do.
Yeah. It's kind of, it feels a little bit like a lie revealed plot.
Right.
And, you know, because Klaus thinks that, well, you've set all this up, and then you're just going to skip town and go back to your life. And it's a little bit of a turn. When I said the story is not blindingly original, that's actually what I was thinking of.
But you know what they do? They resolve it very, very quickly.
Right. That's what I was going to say. Yeah. They don't linger on it.
It happens, and then in practically the next scene, it's resolved.
Yeah.
So they don't really spend much time on it, which I appreciate, because they know that it's not original, but they had to expose that, the real motivations, so that he can learn that he's grown and changed, and so that they can see that, you know, he's a different person even from when this started with the first two or three letters.
It's a good movie. It has a good story. Good. It has a lot of really good goofball humor.
Mm-hmm. Apparently, Jason Schwartzman ad-libbed like 90 or 70% of his lines.
You know what? I can tell.
Yeah.
I can tell. He built the character on that.
Mm-hmm.
And he's very good at it. He's good in the role. But I really did. This is the first time I saw this.
This was really, really good. I'm happy you picked this because
And again, J.K. Simmons is really good. He's got that voice.
Listen, I can't think of a better person to voice Santa Claus, honestly.
And you're sitting there going, okay, this is the same guy who voices the yellow M&M. So he can play dumb, he can play strong, he can play imposing, he can play scary. I mean, he can play just about...
J. Jonah Jameson,
yeah. The teacher in Whiplash, I mean...
What's it, William Frawley?
Yeah, yeah. The dad in Juno, I mean, he's a wonderful actor.
Yeah, and the band leader in Whiplash.
Yeah, yeah. The music teacher, yeah.
That he won his Oscar for, and the it should be noted that the love interest Alva, the teacher, is voiced by none other than the lovely Rashida Jones.
Yes, she's good too.
Yes, she is. I love
her. She's a school teacher, and everybody stopped going to school.
Right, so now she's like the fishmonger.
Yeah. So, all right. Well, let's move on to our next one. Let's talk about The Nightmare Before Christmas.
Oh, okay.
Because this...
this is the only movie that is applicable for Halloween and Christmas.
Oy vey. This came out in 93. Mm-hmm. Christmas of 93. And I remember I went to see it. And I liked it a lot. It didn't do very well. But in the intervening years, the merchandising around this damn movie has exploded. You go into any bookstore, any shop, you will see Nightmare Before Christmas stuff all over the place.
Right. And it it's become a cult classic.
It
grew on home video with my generation and became kind of an annual thing for both holidays. And it took a really long time to grow on me.
It did me too. I had not seen this that much. The thing is, this is a movie. It's very clever because it is incorporating two holidays that are basically on the polar opposites of each other.
And it's a savagely original story.
It is. Even though the story itself is rail thin. There's not a lot of story. And the movie runs what, 80 minutes? It's not long at all.
Yeah, no, 76 minutes.
It's very Burton-esque, even though Burton didn't direct it.
No, but he was was producer, and he kind of came up with the whole concept and everything.
But you could look at this movie, and this was in the middle of the animation renaissance with Disney, and I love the fact that as computers were coming in and about to take over, as all of that technology was happening, you still had a movie that could be made with that handcrafted feel of that stop motion animation. This got an Oscar nomination for its visual effects, lost to Jurassic Park.
Gee, I wonder why.
Yeah, it was Jurassic Park, this, and Cliffhanger. I mean, but it's so, you could watch this with the sound off.
Yeah, it's gorgeous.
It's gorgeous. Every frame of it is beautiful. And but like I say, there's not a whole lot to it. There's not a story that you can really take from it.
The concept,
the premise is really it.
Right. And the way that it presents that is really novel, and the way that they kind of go about it. Thankfully, they know that the story, that there's not much there.
Right.
And they don't drag it out. They don't try to pad it. They just tell their story.
They don't try to fill 2 hours.
Right. They just they tell their story and they move on. Have you ever heard the theory behind who Jack Skellington and Zero are?
No, I haven't.
There's a theory that Frank and Weenie. And the short that Frank and Weenie is based off of, the movie Frank and Weenie, The Corpse Bride, and Nightmare Before Christmas, are all a connected universe.
Oh, nice.
That the dog first in the Frank and Weenie prequel, something happened, it died, whatever, it went to Victor.
Yeah.
Who renamed him Sparky.
I saw the movie.
Yeah.
I didn't see the short.
Renamed him Sparky, and he died, brought him back, died again, and he got another dog, and when he grew up, that dog had died and met the Johnny Depp Victor.
From Corpse Bride.
From the Corpse Bride, he met his old dog, whatever his name was.
Yeah.
Which was the dog that he got after Sparky died the second time and they let him stay dead. And then when he died, that new dog became Sparky, or became Zero. And Jack, the Pumpkin King, was Victor. From the other two movies.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
Nice.
So there's, if you watch them through, that actually can work. And I think Sally, Sally has parts of the Corpse Bride in her.
Okay. I like that she's a ragdoll.
I do too.
I like that she's a ragdoll and Zero is basically a handkerchief.
Yeah. And Catherine,
I just love these designs.
This is the least Catherine O'Hara has ever been.
Was she Sally?
Yeah.
Okay.
Shockingly,
Danny Elfman is the singing voice of Jack.
Yes. Yes.
Is it Chris Sarandon? I think is the speaking voice.
Right.
But I love the textures. I love the mayor. I love Lock, Shock, and Barrel. I love, you know.
The whole of it, it's wildly inventive, visually. The songs.
There's just not a lot to talk about story wise.
There's not a lot to talk about story wise. The songs are worth talking about. Danny Elfman wrote the lyrics to them as well.
You know, the songs are so good. When I was watching this again, I almost wish this was a full musical.
I know.
I thought, okay, you could take out the dialogue.
Yeah.
And you could just have this be a musical. But again, you're so invested in what you're looking at.
Right.
The story doesn't get in the way.
Right. The visuals are what really matter. And they know that, and you're right. The story doesn't get in the way. The story
Even need a villain.
The story, it doesn't really have, well, I guess Oogie Boogie.
Oogie Boogie is the villain. But he kind of comes into this movie sideways.
He's kind of ancillary. I would call him a villain, but not the villain. The villain noticed, is ironically kind of Jack.
Have you noticed they haven't tried to do like they do with any popular Christmas movie? They haven't tried to do like shorts or
there's no like Christmas specials story. Yeah,
there's no continuing story. I noticed this movie is contained and on its own. There's been no real effort to try to build on it.
Right, because
I'm okay with that.
The only reason it happened was because he was curious about something else when he experienced it. Then he just went back to Halloween. So yeah. Anything after this would just be watching him do Halloween, which we've seen.
Right.
Like there's nowhere for the story to go.
Yeah. But I'll tell you this. One story that really never had anywhere to go and did all of it and did everything right the first time was Beauty and the Beast.
Yeah. I still, what you said, you gave me this list. You went, okay. The list went Klaus, Nightmare Before Christmas, Tokyo Godfathers, Beauty and the Beast, The Enchanted Christmas. And I said, boy, that fourth one was a really tough one to get to, wasn't it?
Well, you were on a roll there.
And you said, actually, that was the first one I chose. And I was like, oh.
No, actually, well, I take it back. The first one I actually solidified on the list was Klaus. But I did Beauty and the Beast and Enchanted Christmas just because I had to throw something Disney in here, and I really wanted to talk about this because
Nightmare Before Christmas was a touchstone picture. That was it was always been owned by Disney.
Is it always owned? Oh, okay. Well, Nightmare Before Christmas was also a late addition to this.
True.
It came after Beauty and the Beast. And I wanted to talk about this because this was the first Disney animated knockoff sequel after they had already done two really crummy-looking Aladdin sequels.
Yeah, they were.
And it was before they started throwing them together.
Mm-hmm.
Because this movie is not really bad. It's just unnecessary.
Yeah,
there's no consistency in it.
Right, because they're basically taking us within the montage, and there's a montage. There's a montage for a reason.
There's a giant question mark at the beginning of this movie because the framework is that all of the servants in the house, when we meet them, they're all human.
Right.
We meet Lumiere and Cogsworth, Mrs. Potts and Chip. We meet everybody, and they're all in their human forms. And apparently, it's a year later. So, Chip gets Mrs. Potts to sit down and tell the story of how they saved Christmas last year.
Yeah, right. It's last year.
Me sitting down to talk to someone about, you know, tell the tale about a Christmas last year, and they were there.
Right. It's you know? there's a Mystery Science Theater 3000 episode called The Phantom Planet that had a penchant for flashing back, right? Mm-hmm. And at the end of the movie, it starts flashing back all the way through, and it literally flashes back to the previous scene.
Yeah.
And Crow screams at it, "You can't flash back to something you just did 10 seconds ago!" That's what I felt.
I remember
was.
This happened in Rocky IV.
Yeah, and I yelled about it there too.
after Apollo was killed, and he has an argument with Adrian on the stairs, and then he goes out and gets in his really expensive sports car to drive around and feel bad about himself. And he has these flashbacks.
You just saw 10 seconds ago.
He has flashbacks to the two previous, to the other movies, and then flashes back to the conversation he just had with Adrian. Oh. It's you can't flash back to something you did 10 seconds ago. That's not flashing back. That means it's still on your mind. But she tells a story that she tells the tale of how they saved Christmas the year before, which I'm thinking, why do we need the update? Just have it be during the time that she was held prisoner. We meet Belle, and let me tell you something. If Belle had been the person in this movie, in the original movie that she was in this, we would have hated her guts, because in the original she had all of this emotion and all of these this personality and all these mixed emotions. Here she's just kind of a ninny.
Yeah.
And there's not really a character there.
No, she's
basically
she's
the story is
basically played.
Basically the story is she wants to give the Beast a Christmas, a nice Christmas. And we find out, by the way, that the Beast's real name is Prince Adam, because there's a flashback to the flashback within a flashback. So Mrs. Potts is telling a story within a story. Right. So we actually get to see.
Work?
I don't know.
Like
I don't know.
She's sitting there, and then, you know, she says, and then the wavy lines came through, and we went back to the time before. Yeah. I thought that I thought Jason Alexander was the voice of the aggressive,
no, it's Jeff Glenn
the,
Bennett.
The aggressive
there
Jewish
is...
axe. The...
Okay, when you say Jewish axe, it's not a Jewish actor. It's not just a Jewish actor playing this.
No,
it, I mean, it's an axe, and it's going. It is. I mean.
It's doing full
Jackie Mason.
It's full Yentl. It's full Fiddler.
It's full Jackie Mason.
It's
you know, it's with the chopping and the hitting and the oi vey.
I mean,
it's exactly
it is,
like that.
It is almost offensive. Like
this, and he does say oi vey.
He does. Like
and they never bring up Hanukkah ever.
Actually, yes they do.
Do they?
He says Merry Christmas and Happy Hanukkah.
Okay. Well, he gives it lip service.
Yeah.
But they don't actually have a celebration for Hanukkah.
Well,
and you don't see him in the present time.
No, you don't.
No, but seriously, it is he is really doing, because the crux of it is that now the good part of this movie is the villain. I like the villain. The villain is the Beast's organ, voiced by Tim Curry. And he has a really good motivation. He doesn't want to end the curse because he likes being an organ.
Well,
his name is Forte.
He likes the attention that the Beast
mm-hmm.
gives him, because he plays all this melancholic music and it keeps the Beast in a melancholic mood, and that's all he really knows how to play. So when it flashes back and he's like, okay, play something for me, play, and oh, it's an original thing, it's like, it's really gloomy.
So I mean, look, it's voiced by Tim Curry. So I mean, every time he sings, it sounds like he's getting in your pants. You know, I mean, well, he convinces Belle to go out and get a Christmas tree because she gets all the trimmings. He doesn't like Christmas because apparently the curse was put on him at Christmas. And she has to go out and get a tree, and he says, no, you have to go to the Black Forest. And so he leaves
the
grounds,
and she said
right.
She would never leave the castle grounds. Flippity blobbity boobity bobbity boobity bobbity bop. He gets mad.
And I don't know about you. I don't know about you. Okay. in the movie, the Beast was very sullen because of his, because of the curse. Mm-hmm. He was very sour. He was very sullen. But you felt that he understood. You felt the weight of that on him. Here, he's just pissed off.
Yeah.
It's like he's just pissed off. He's angry every time she does anything. And it's like it kind of takes away from the romantic element of it because the character's not written well.
Yeah, well, you know? I mean, that's why this is superfluous and really just holy.
The animation, I'll say, the animation is good for these things. It's better than the Aladdin movies.
That's a low bar.
It's not a bad movie. It's just
not a good one either.
It's just not a very good one either. But you can feel them struggling to get a story out of this, a Christmas story, and it's hard to do.
It is, and it's just all right.
It's oy vey, as the axe would say.
Oy gewalt.
So let's move on to much higher ground.
Oh,
we're gonna end this with a beautiful film called Tokyo Godfathers. Shimino Ono's Tokyo Godfathers, which he based on John Ford's Three Godfathers. Mm-hmm. And if you know Ona's films, he makes very weird, bizarre fantasy stuff that will screw with your brain. This is the most down-to-earth film he's ever made. It's one of the most human, one of the most heartwarming films I've ever seen. Mm-hmm. It questions what makes a family. We meet three homeless people. You'll have to help me with the names. There is a former drag performer named Hana.
Miss Hana, and
Miss Hana.
There is
a former gambler.
Right. Right, named Jin.
MTN, yes.
There is a young 20-ish-year-old girl.
Runaway.
That was a runaway. Her name is Miyuki.
Miyuki, yes. They are in Tokyo in the middle of a middle of seemingly endless snowstorm.
And it's Christmas.
And it's Christmas. And we meet them. And as they're talking, they hear a baby cry.
Right, they're dumpster diving.
Right.
Because Miss Hana had found this encyclopedia of great literature that she wanted to give to Miyuki for Christmas. And so they were looking for it, and they couldn't find it. And a baby starts crying. And... And they get it, and there's stuff with it to, you know, to help to take care of it, just initially. And they're kind of drawn to it.
It's abandoned, kind of like, please take care of my baby. Mm-hmm. It's that kind of situation. The movie is a journey. It's a few days in these people's lives.
It's basically Christmas. It's the week after Christmas. It's like Christmas Eve through the calendar New Year.
But this is not Ice Age. You know, we've got to get the baby to this place.
Oh no. Well, sort of.
It's not like that. It's a similar story, but it's not quite like that. You got a trio of friends who form a family, and they've got to get, but they're not trying to, that they don't seem to ever really be trying to get the baby somewhere. You just kind of,
well, they're trying to at least track the parents down, who they think the parents are. Mm-hmm. Because they go,
but there doesn't ever seem to be an urgency to do so. it's not an urgency because this movie is not interested in getting to a place. It's interested in the adventures that they have along the way and getting to know them and getting to know what their circumstances are. How did they end up on the street? How did they end up together?
How much of what they tell each other is true versus
right
what really happened? And like Jin and Hannah,
Hannah probably has the most expected background of the three,
but she also has
she's a trans woman, by the way.
She's colored over her past. They don't know. I think they might know that she was a drag performer.
She does tell the story, because she was a drag performer who was working in a club, and one night a rowdy customer got really offensive, and she decked him. Mm-hmm. And in shame and humiliation, Miss Hannah left. What I didn't understand, and maybe I missed something, she goes back to that club.
Yeah.
And the headliner, the owner is there and has a lot of pity for her. Right. And I thought, because I thought you could build your career back up, though.
Well, she was convinced that she couldn't go back because that happened.
Because of what she had done.
And in Japan, and kind of in that kind of a club atmosphere, if your behavior leads to your termination of one place, other places won't hire you because they already know what you'll do. So when they do go back, and they go back there because Hannah's looking for a little help, and they wind up finding Jin. They'd been separated, and he'd been beaten mm-hmm. by some
street kids,
street punks that just decided to start beating up some homeless people.
And they beat up an old man.
Well, he was already dead.
He was already dead. That old man plays a key factor in the ending that I love.
That they find him there, and the owner, the boss, says, you know, that was smoothed over with a little bit of money. That was not nearly as important as you thought it was, and mm-hmm. you didn't have to do what you did.
Yeah.
You don't need to be where you are right now.
Yeah.
And
this is a very full story. It's a very human story.
Yeah. And the girl, Miyuki, she's a runaway. Her father is a police officer.
She stabbed him.
Yeah, in a family altercation, that, and she felt terrible about that. But
in a family altercation that had a very unfortunate misunderstanding.
Yeah.
What I am really impressed by, because I love Japanese animation, because their style is very broad. You know, when we talked about Merry Christmas, Mr. Lawrence, I talked about how the Japanese very often have a style that's very big, mm-hmm. very a lot of wild gestures, mm-hmm. a lot of you know, over the top. It's very theatrical. Mm-hmm. They do that in their animation too. Mm-hmm. They do that here. Because the story is not... This is not Grave of the Fireflies, thank God. this is a film in which there's a comic undertone.
Yeah, it's a very good-natured... It's not a... It's
a very good-natured... It's got a big heart.
It's not a depressing movie. It's not...
Not at all. Not at all.
It's not sad, despite the fact that you're spending time with
three homeless people
that... realistically, if they would have kind of thought for just a minute they wouldn't have to be in the position that they're in.
Right.
But, but if they weren't in that position, that baby would have died.
You know what? I thought about that. I thought there's you couldn't do this in live action because the circumstances would seem much more grim.
The only person that
baby needs so much attention.
The only person
attention.
That I would want to make this if they turned this live action would be Guillermo del Toro.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think he's one of the only ones that could do that right.
Look, I saw this. I saw this for this show because I had seen it sometime before 2010, and I absolutely loved it.
Yeah, I had never seen
but I'm glad to introduce it to you.
Yeah, I'm glad.
I hope this becomes an annual.
I've written it on my annual Christmas list. This is going to be a perennial. I watched this today, and my only regret was that I didn't really have an opportunity to watch it a second time before we recorded.
This is about the third time I've seen it. Because I watched it initially, and then I watched it about a week when right after I picked it.
Right. We're
and unfortunately, recording this a few days before Christmas.
Yeah, we're recording this Christmas week, and I feel like I'm going to wind up watching it again this week.
Yeah. You don't think that you're going to enjoy it as much as you do. What's great about it is it's one of those movies where you are absorbed in what's going on.
The characters really you disarm think you. And
they do.
They disarm you, and you're with them immediately. You are
right.
You are part of their family instantaneously because of how
you hear the
how full these characters are right out of the gate,
and you hear the premise, and it puts you off.
It does.
Three homeless people find a baby, and they spend a couple of days trying to. It kind of puts you
over
off because you're like, okay,
and you're like, oh,
and it's a Japanese animated
Christmas,
film,
and it's in Japan. And they are not afraid of just killing everybody.
Right. I'm going to tell you something. The first time I saw this, not to give anything away, the first time I saw this, I did not know if that baby would survive.
Hey, there's that's kind of the beauty of specifically East Asian animation, non-mainstream American animation. If you get into the not the big studios, but the more independent animation stuff, you'll get some things like this. But you wouldn't feel the way you do if this were set in New York City.
I've been circling around this. This show was originally going to be four foreign films that take place at Christmas, and this was going to be one of them.
Worked.
I just didn't have time to research the other. I'll probably do that next year, but
there's a lot of European Christmas movies.
There are. But this was... It wasn't what I expected, because I expected something more like Grave of the Fireflies or the one you picked a few years ago. Not the Christmas film, but
the
what was that one?
The Hiroshima one.
The one about Hiroshima. I can't remember the name of it, but
I'll think of it.
I expected something like that.
Right.
With a sour ending, dire circumstances. This is kind of lighter. This is a lot lighter than that.
It is, despite the subject matter. It is set up as kind of a wacky comedy.
And they're a family.
Yes.
They love each other.
They're a
they really fight with each other.
Beautiful found family.
Right. They fight with each other. They get on each other's nerves, and they look out for each other.
Yeah.
And it's so great because it's like, and I love the character of Hannah, mm-hmm. because she is so specifically drawn. Now, I will warn people going to see this. And I told you this, there's some language in it that's a little dated. They do use the F word. And I was a little put off with that. That comes in at the beginning of the film. But I think if you can get past that and really get into the characters, I think people will really love this. I was surprised at where the story ended. I was surprised at... I'm not going to talk about the ending because I want people to understand. I want people to see it for themselves. But mm-hmm. When the story is over, it is life goes on. Mm-hmm. The circumstances haven't changed all that much. But... it is life goes on. I did get this feeling that probably these three could get off the streets, mm-hmm. Very easily. I don't know. Now the immediate motivation is to take care of the baby.
Right.
But they could easily probably change their circumstances very easily. But they're looking out for each other. There's a scene in the middle of the film that is unbearably sad when Ryuki, Ryuki's the baby. When Jin finds where he used to live. And it's trashed.
Yeah.
And that was unbearably sad. That's about as sad as this film gets. Yeah. But the button on that scene is life goes on. Mm-hmm. And you can't dwell on it. You can't dwell on the past. Right. They're confronted with their past, but they're not dominated by it. Because they have to move on.
Right. And each of them forgives the others for not being fully truthful.
Right.
Because
right.
they all realize that there's stuff about their circumstances that they don't want to admit out loud. Mm-hmm. And
well, they don't want to go there.
Right, but eventually they do. Mm-hmm. Because they finally do realize that they are a family.
Mm-hmm.
No one more than Mayuki when she has that dream that she's dreaming about her biological parents, and they turn into Hana and Jin and Kayuki.
Yeah.
So it was... I also really liked that Kyoko was Jin's daughter's name.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And you find out he talks about, he says that she died and his wife died shortly after, when really mm-hmm. his circumstances were virtually identical to this guy that they're finding that they think might be the father to this child.
Right.
And he gets angry about it because he's seeing someone else do what he did.
Yeah.
And there's a really touching scene at the hospital that she's like the admissions nurse at the ED.
Mm-hmm.
That's treating him, I think.
Yeah.
And
that scene where he finds out that she's his daughter is, that's my favorite scene in the movie.
It's beautiful.
Because he's standing there at that window and she says, "Dad," and they start playing Ode to Joy.
Yeah.
I love that. Because you expect some kind of weepy, dramatic music. No, it's Ode to Joy. Because it's playing on the TV. I love that. But I want people to find it. I want people to discover this film. It is really good. I found it on Tubi because I had the DVD and it got lost in my move when I moved a couple of years ago. But I want people to find this one. I don't want to say too much more about it, but maybe next year we can do a full episode on it. But
yeah, pair it with Three Godfathers or something.
Three Godfathers, yeah. Yeah. But that's pretty much all I got.
Yeah, that's all I have. And that wraps it up for this year here at the Pod Bay Doors. This is our technically our last numbered episode, even though there will be one posted after this, but the numbering
right.
will be technically this is our last episode of the year.
The next episode
is supposed to be the one that would have aired before this episode, but because we want to get this up before Christmas, we're shifting.
And we do have one episode after that, which we do this every year. We're going to talk about the movies of 2022.
In this corner of the world. Sorry.
Yes.
In this corner of the world, 2016. It was actually...
That was the movie that you were... Yeah, that was the movie you were thinking of about Hiroshima.
Yeah. Sorry. I had to find it.
yeah, but our last episode will be the movie year 2022. We're going to talk about some of the films we've seen, including one of the most beautiful animated films I've ever seen in my whole life. Oh. Thank you, Guillermo del Toro.
Thank you.
And
for
I always look forward
watching
to
it. I'm.
Oh my god.
I'm very happy that you saw it because
I watched it and I cried. I showed it to a friend of mine and she cried.
It's just. We'll talk.
And it was literally. It was literally. I'm not crying. You're crying.
Right. Right. And you're like, did it get dusty in here?
Allergies.
It's winter. Pollen.
What's funny is as we're coming up to the end of that movie, I just put the Kleenex box between us on the couch because I was like, okay, I know what's coming.
It, yeah, I. Now you just need to see Everything Everywhere All at Once.
I'm gonna see that tonight.
Oh, it's so good. That and Pinocchio.
But Merry Christmas to everyone.
Yes. Happy Christmas. Happy New Year.
Happy Hanukkah.
Happy Hanukkah. Happy Kwanzaa. Happy Festivus.
Whatever you.
Happy.
However you celebrate the
whatever,
holidays.
Whatever you do.
And Happy New Year.
Whatever you do, have a good time responsibly with it. You can find all of our back episodes at the podbaydoorspodcast.wordpress.com. You can. Listen to us on iTunes and YouTube. Hit the like, subscribe, and notifications buttons there. Also, find us on Twitter. Still, I guess.
We think.
At pod_bay. Copy and paste that over on to Patreon, and you will find us there. We thank you very much for joining us, and the Pod Bay doors are now closed.
The mission had been completed.
Boys and girls of every age, wouldn't you like to see something strange?
Come with us and you will see this our town of Halloween. This is Halloween.
I am the one hiding under your bed. teeth ground sharp and eyes glowing red.
I am the one hiding under your stairs. Fingers like snakes and spiders in my hair.
This is Halloween, this is Halloween, 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 Halloween.
In this town we call home, everyone hail to the pumpkin soul.
In this town, don't we love it now? Everybody's waiting for the next surprise.
Round that corner and hiding in the trash can, something's waiting at a punch and pound.
Hooray, this is Halloween!
Red and black.
It's bloody green.
Aren't you scared?
Well, that's just fine.
Say it once, say it twice, take a chance and roll the dice. Ride with the moon in the dead of night.
Everybody scream! Everybody scream!
In our town of Halloween,
I am the clown with the tearaway face!
Here in a flash and gone with a trace!
I am the who in the corner who's there!
I am the wind blowing through your hair!
I am the shadow on the moon at night, filling your dreams to the brim with fright!
This is Halloween! This is Halloween! 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 Halloween!
That's our job,
but we're not mean.
In our town of Halloween,
in this town, don't we love it now? Everyone's waiting for the next surprise.
Skeleton Jack might catch you in the back and
scream like a bat, you make you jump
out of your skin.
This is Halloween,
everybody scream.
Won't you please make way for a very special guy?
Lawman Jack is king of the pumpkin patch. Everyone fails in the pumpkin king.
Call home, everyone hail to the pumpkin song.